those of you who don't know Constitution Rights Foundation, we're a nonprofit. We're located in Los Angeles, although we work locally in Los Angeles, statewide in California, as well as nationally. And one of our large national programs is our Civic Action Project. We also send out our Bill of Rights in Action, which goes out to about 40,000 teachers across the nation. Always includes a world history and U.S. history, current events, and it's a great publication. It's free, and you can sign up to get that on our website. It has content reading as well as activities that you can take right into the classroom.
So the Lou Frey Institute at the University of Central Florida in Orlando, Florida, is a K-12 civics education organization. We kind of do comprehensive civics, all things related. So teacher professional development, curriculum materials, assessment support, and action civics. And one of the kind of umbrella pieces to our organization is the Florida Joint Center for Citizenship. And that group specifically focuses on K-12 instruction, but we are housed at the Lou Frey Institute.
Great, and we're just excited to have FJCC as our partner on this project. And today we're gonna introduce you to the Civic Action Project for middle school students. We'll show you the free curriculum that you can get just by registering. We'll overview the project planners that help the students as they do their Civic Action Project. We'll also see an example of real student work. We'll show you a couple features on the CAP website and then just talk about some culminating activities.
So we're thinking to start off the webinar by asking all of you to think of a response to the next prompt. And that prompt is, how do you promote development of engaged citizens in your classroom? Through specific activities, lesson plans, field trips, any sort of civic experience that you've integrated or incorporated into your traditional classroom instruction to promote the development of engaged citizens. So we'll give you a couple of seconds or minutes to think about what are some of the practices that you're currently doing. It could be video, watching specific video, assigning specific articles or reading. Mock elections. Very good, which happens to be one of the proven practices that have been validated by research by having students simulate democratic processes in the classroom as being one of the effective ways to familiarize them with the democratic process. Public service projects, we're going to be covering some of that today. Giving students the experience of actually organizing and developing an effort to address an important community problem issue or need. So Chris, if you'd like to maybe look, give us a quick overview of this article that you found that demonstrates that this has been a challenge for a very long time in this country.
Yeah, so this is a headline from the New York Times, and it was originally published in 1928. So we're looking at a 91-year-old headline. And I thought this was particularly poignant because it gets to the root that we've been having this debate for quite some time. You know, we haven't really figured out the best way of engaging our students and really getting them the opportunity to practice the skills of good democracy, the opportunities to deliberate, collaborate, and build those civic relationships. So when I saw this headline, it immediately jumped out at me, and I thought, you know, one of the ways that we can address this is through the Civic Action Project, because the Civic Action Project does exactly that. It does help our youth how to learn to use the Constitution by being able to engage their elected officials, by examining a public policy problem and coming up with solutions, and then sharing those solutions in a way that is conducive to the material and content that they're learning in the classroom. So, you know, here we are 91 years later and in essence still having that same debate.
So we've mentioned several times already Civic Action Project. So what is the Civic Action Project? We frequently refer to it as a web-based practice zone for teaching civics in U.S. government. You might want to add experiencing civics in U.S. government. As I mentioned, it's web-based. All of the resources we're going to overview today are available on the website for free, including all of the handouts that you'll need to to deliver every lesson in the classroom. It's policy-based. This is a critical element of the entire CAP process. We want students to make policy connections to some of the issues that they've decided to address. We want them to emerge from this experience feeling confident enough to influence the decisions of policymakers in their community, because that's what's going to make their efforts sustainable over time, even beyond that initial direct service project. If they get it to the policy level, that's where it will become sustainable. Or as I tell students all the time, policy determines how the resources and the money is spent in your community. Standards-based, because we're very sensitive to the fact that teachers need to make sure that everything that they do teach in the classroom does reinforce content. And student-driven, and this is where the buy-in to CAP occurs. Students are the ones that identify the issue, problem, or need that they want to investigate, but they also get to decide each step of the process as they develop their CAP projects. And we've developed a couple of tools that facilitate that process for them.
So we're going to take a moment to see an example of student work. And as you take a look at this video, like you to see if you can identify, one, what the issue is that the students are working on. Two, could you see some sort of policy connection? And three, what were all the different types of actions that you saw the students do? So those are the three things that we're going to work on, we're going to look at on this video.
You might not know what could happen. You might get in a clash, or the person isn't paying attention, and the people could get in a car accident.
I believe it, but still, Bulfer just shouldn't be done anyway. But in the news and in social media, you see plenty of stories of people dying because they're texting and driving at the same time. It just can't be done.
Really?
It shouldn't be that way, and that people should be careful what they do and control themselves.
It's out there where people have been texting and driving, and it's horrific accidents. Too many deaths, just don't do it.
I feel that it does kill other people when you text and drive.
Drinking can't be done either. You shouldn't be driving behind the wheel. You should have a designated driver for that.
It should go at least a little bit up, because they should know what they did and earn up to it.
I think you should say the same, because like, you're wasting people's money and basically nothing.
I think you should not text and drive because millions of lives died.
I think that the punishment for texting and driving should be jail time or a higher fee.
Loss of license.
I think that the punishment should be a lot of money, and I think that they should take the license away.
Young people were concerned about?
The problem or issue that students investigated and focused. Yes, texting and driving.
That's right, texting while driving. Now, did you notice a policy connection that the students were able to link their issue to policies somewhat?
Yeah.
We'll go ahead and
just
share with you. So really, they were able to look at, they were able to identify that Florida had a policy of between $20 and $100 when they caught people
for texting while driving. But they're also able to identify policies in other states. We were looking at these other states and realized that some states have stricter policies, some have less. So they really were able to dive in to figure out how policies connect with their issue. And then finally, actions. Feel free to put it in the chat section. If not, I'll just go over some of the big actions that I saw, right? The students first, they conducted research. It looks like they did some interviews. They interviewed at least a teacher or possibly an administrator. They interviewed other students.
They also created this video that can actually serve as a baton to the next group of students that might choose the same exact issue. Instead of them starting from scratch, they can actually look at this video and maybe pick up from where these students left off. One thing I'd like to say about some of the recommendations when students were asked what they think should be done, you might have noticed that pretty much all of their recommendations are punitive, either make the punishment, the fines, raise the fines, have them lose their license. What I always try to encourage students is to also think of policy that may incentivize positive behavior. That's something that can provide balance to the approach, because what they may find is that a lot of these issues are almost exclusively only dealt with through punitive policies and laws, and yet the problem still continues. Maybe they can consider how they may develop a policy to incentivize positive behavior among individuals so that they can address the need or problem more effectively.
So that was a real student project. It was from students out of Florida. And I don't know, Chris, do you want to mention maybe some other topics that you've seen students work on?
Sure. And, you know, before we actually talk about other topics, so this video was created, you know, a few years ago. And this particular group of students, they're now high school students, but they had persisted. And while I don't necessarily know there's a direct link, but through their persistence, Florida actually just this July 1st strengthened its texting and driving laws. So, you know, through the sheer will of students as well as other Floridians, the legislature finally paid attention. It's not necessarily the strongest anti-texting law on the books in the country, but it's certainly, you know, far more significant than it was ever before. So, you know, I mention that because it's important that students understand that they do have a voice and that there are issues that impact them and that there are issues that they care about. And so through their investigation of policy, they can figure out ways in which things can be addressed, in this instance, strengthened. So it definitely contributes to, you know, a positive that, you know, Floridians are now being more cautious and more aware of how they drive on the roads. But this was just one of the things that's come out of Florida. We've had students be particularly interested in mental health of students, especially after the Parkland shootings in Broward County. We've had students take on domestic violence issues. I think I've shared this example in the past, but we've had students actually petition their county commission because the closest domestic violence shelter was over an hour away, and students thought that was too far, especially for someone who was in crisis and emergency to have to go. And they actually made their appeal to the commission. You know, they learned very quickly that, you know, in this instance, dollars were the question, but you know, they were resilient. I mean, they took their cause to the commission, and they were heard. But what are some of the other things we've had? Obviously, the texting and driving, suicide awareness. We've had you know, a number of students take that on. As you can imagine, in Florida, school safety has become particularly important for students, and so advocating you know, the wearing of student ID badges or having more cameras or safety locks on the doors. So those are some of the things that the kids have championed. And in some instances, they've actually been able to, you know, get things done, especially if the dollar amount is low. Students at the schools that had addressed the need to have student IDs worn so that everybody would know who everybody was, that went into effect. Raising awareness on the mental health issue, students had designed posters that the school district ended up printing and distributing to all of the schools in Orange County. So they are making a difference. And when they're before that authentic audience, it really does make a difference for them. So,
you know, what's really interesting, the range of topics that you just mentioned these students came up with just by being provided a platform like that, from macro issues like suicide awareness, texting and driving, to school-based issues, just little stuff that they think would just make things more convenient for them at school. And I think that's typical of this, our experience with CAP. You provide students with the platform, you let them choose the issue, and that's where the buy-in occurs, and then they really dig in. That's a really great example too, Chris, how the students sustain their effort to really start influencing some of the decisions and really learning what it's like to be an effective citizen to address something important in their community.
Right.
So some of you may be asking, how do we get there? How do we get the students to this point where they become aware enough and engaged enough to really start developing effective projects to address these issues? So when you log into the CAP website, what will happen is it will direct you to this landing page, which is your teacher dashboard. You'll notice that there are two boxes, and one is for lessons for required government course, lessons for elective government course. For the purposes of this workshop, what we're going to do is we're going to focus on those lessons required for the government course. And when we take a look at that, we look at lesson number one, what is an effective citizen? Each lesson has an overview. The civic mission of schools proven practices that each lesson is designed to address. There are six, one of them being, as I mentioned earlier, simulations inside the classroom, such as moot court activity, mock elections. We've aligned to the Florida standards for one of the important reasons is that Florida actually has legislation that has middle school students completing an exit exam on civics, and this is something that actually supports something that's really important for the teachers to accomplish or for the students to learn before they actually graduate to high school. Each lesson has a list of objectives or what the lesson is designed to do or what the lesson will be or what the students will be doing to complete the lesson. A materials list, including all of the handouts, which we have right here, downloadable PDF versions that you'll need to deliver the lesson in the classroom. Finally, a procedure section, which is step-by-step instructions for delivering the lesson with your students. On the left-hand column, you'll see the result of this first lesson, which is a citizenship brainstorm, where students brainstorm effective traits or characteristics of citizens along the categories of knowledge, skills, attitudes, and actions. Or, what does an effective citizen need to know? What are some of the attitudes they need to have? What are some of the actions they need to take in order to be effective to address a problem or issue in the community? What's really great about this activity is you get the result right here, which is an actual profile of effective citizenship that is a direct reflection of what the students think are the important knowledge, skills, and dispositions for getting things done in their community. Such as the knowledge responses, they put up here on the head. On the arms, they put their skills responses. On the legs, the actions. And right here in that middle section, the torso, they put the list of responses for those for the attitudes. So it's a fun lesson, but what's really important is that it not only establishes the context of what their CAP experience is going to be or what it's designed to provide, but it also demystifies that concept of citizenship and allows them to create a personal relationship and one that's really going to guide them as they continue to develop their CAP project. In the second lesson, they do an introduction of policy. Once again, the same format, overview, standards, objective, materials list. And in this lesson, and once again, procedures, step-by-step instructions for delivering the lesson. And in this lesson, students will complete a cause and effect activity. And in this case, we've given them the topic of litters to brainstorm on. Now, you can also have the students apply this exercise to the specific problem or need that they're going to be addressing, which can also be a very effective way of doing this lesson. So that's the worksheet. So what they do is they come up with some primary root causes and effects. And that begins to allow them to narrow the focus of what their CAP project is going to be. I want to make sure I don't forget anything. This is an important part of the exercise as well. where they looked at a couple of policy scenarios and asked some of these questions related to those policies, because it's really important that they become very familiar with not only why how policies are made and who makes them, but the impact, the daily impact it has on their lives. The next lesson, lesson three. Once again, the same format for the lesson. And in this lesson, students will actually assume the role of political candidates who will articulate their platform based on what they've already accomplished by completing the citizenship profile and also their cause and effects chart. And what the listeners, the other students in the classroom will have, they'll have a candidate scorecard, and they'll be grading or evaluating their pitch to see just how effective or how persuasive they were in terms of convincing them that the issue that they decided or that they looked at is a very important or urgent issue to address. They're then introduced to the project proposal planner. This is essentially a series of prompts that not only allows the student to document each step of the developing the project, but it also allows the teacher to monitor their progress. But it's really important because it's essentially, I like to refer to it as the roadmap to civic action. It constantly asks them, what is the issue they want to work on? Why is it important to work on? What is the policy connection? And what will be their next civic action? So these are some of the three core lessons that at this point students are beginning to develop their projects, beginning to fill out the project planners. But Chris, I know you also have, from this point, you also have a list of what you consider to be really the essential lessons to really get the students started on their projects and getting started on a strong foot. So could you maybe share what some of the lessons are or the sequence of lessons that you recommend or that you've implemented with your students?
Sure, absolutely. So time is always a concern. And at least here in Florida, the breadth and depth of the content that our teachers have to get through oftentimes keeps them from being able to do these practical application activities. And so we know from the research that we do a really great job with the knowledge, but there's a gap with the application of skills. So in looking at these lessons, if we focus on lessons 1, 2, 3, and then jump to 6, what we're doing is we're hitting all of the policy lessons. You know, when we look at lesson 1, we're, you know, explaining to the students, you know, what an effective citizen is. So we're building on that idea of, you know, the important knowledge, the important skills, the dispositions and actions that they take. And then when we move into lesson 2, it's that implications of policy, you know, and really beginning to, you know, understand, you know, what policy does, how it works. Sometimes it's the causes of an issue. Sometimes it's a cure for an issue, whatever the case happens to be. And then they get into their proposal. So they've investigated, they've looked at these things, and now they're going to actually propose something. And once they get into that phase, and then you move into lesson 6 so that you're really starting to investigate the implication aspect, now you then can move towards the civic actions. Civic actions C through F will end up filling out that essential core, because this is where those foundations are going to be laid for the students. These are the lessons that allow them to examine where they've been, where they are, and where they're headed. And for the teacher, it also provides ample opportunity to act as a facilitator, because they're constantly revisiting their investigatory question, their essential question, if you will, you know, their major research of focus. And when you provide that opportunity to reevaluate, in the way that the planners scaffold, the students are really able to hone what it is that they're working on. They're really able to focus on that specific change. And the way that the planners are designed is it gives them that opportunity to kind of go back and reflect and make any course corrections that are needed. But when you look at those 4 key lessons and then lessons C through F, we're talking about, you know, a handful that can be integrated as you maneuver the content. And as the content expert for your classroom, you know when it would be appropriate to go ahead and interject these themes over the course of your school year or even over the course of your semester. But it does give them that opportunity to be able to, you know, investigate those real life issues. And these are the lessons that really provide that opportunity for the rubber to meet the road, because you're giving them that content, but now you're giving them that opportunity to be able to practice, really, you know, sink their teeth into what you've taught them.
Chris mentioned a lot about those planners. We're going to show you where those are. So back at your dashboard, right? You'll see that there's two dashboards. It's actually the teacher dashboard, and you just scroll down a little bit. This is the student dashboard. And on this dashboard, you'll see a chat section, you'll see your planners, you'll see a nice video on your right. That video is kind of an illustration for students that they might have, if they're having any trouble connecting their issue to policy. They can watch this video and see how there's different ways different issues connect to policy. But if you click on here, this is where you'll find the planners.
So they're the student planners, but if you go back to the dashboard, you can see the teacher. The blank one, I think those are the ones right here, the planners. And this is the proposal planner, which we were looking at earlier. But there are several other planners that help the students once again. This is where they indicate to the teacher what it is they plan to work on, what they're going to be focusing on. As a result of their initial actions and research, they move on to the thinking it through planner. This is an opportunity for them to maybe shift gears. Maybe what they thought was the primary cause or effect when they started the project, their research has now maybe led them in another direction. And this is where they're going to document shifting gears. The civic action planners, they're essentially, once again, a series of prompts that the students will complete and let you know what they're doing every step of the way. This is actually the project report. This is actually the very final one, which is a reflection. But those civic action planners, once again, they help the students document every step of their project and also anticipate what the next step will be. And it's really important that they document this, as I always constantly tell students, if it's not in writing, it's almost as if it never happened. And what's really important about them documenting this is that this could be part of the civic legacy they leave behind after they complete this project and maybe move on to high school. This is something that the next group of students can pick up on and pick up where they left off to continue trying to address that particular issue in their community. Because most likely students are not going to solve something like drug abuse or domestic violence in the course of a semester or a year. They can definitely move that effort one step in the right direction and pass the baton on to another group of students who might pick that same issue the next year or semester. And that's how you create a civic culture, or effort to develop a culture of civics at a school, and it also let the students leave some sort of civic legacy that others can build on after they're gone.
So I went back to the student page. You could see that how do students complete these planners? Right? So they have some basic information that you as a teacher have taught them, but really they should be using this toolkit as a way to move their project forward. So you can see that it's separated into different sections. There's a research section, a create path awareness section, building support, influencing policy. Within each of these sections, you'll notice that there are several small resources for the students. So for example, maybe one of the first things students are going to want to do to move their path forward is to create an opinion poll, but they might not know how to do that, right? So here's a simple two to three page PDF that'll give an example, tell you what an opinion poll is, give you an example of how to create one, as well as provide you some more information about what should be included in an opinion poll. That's one example. There might be creating a flyer. Maybe students want to get their information out there by creating a flyer. They can read the short one-page PDF. They can see, okay, flyers usually include a headline. It usually tells you the purpose of the flyer. It gives you the message. It tells you to put an image in. So for really anything that students are doing, there is probably something in the toolkit that they can use to move their project forward. They could be using the media. They can be how to create a website. Some other things like how to set up an interview with a legislator, or how to even create a thank you letter. I mean, people today don't necessarily know what should be in the thank you email after they interview someone. So it just, again, real brief
one page and provides an example of what it is that you want students to do.
This is the web page that you as a teacher direct students to if they ask, what should I do next? You simply refer them to the toolkit and ask them to look for a civic action that they can apply to their project to develop it further. We are very sensitive to the fact that the teacher, you teach the lesson in the classroom, and the students develop their project afterwards, and the toolkit is designed to help them do that.
So two other quick notes on the student dashboard. You have a student action page, which includes some examples of student work. So again, this might be a nice way for you to introduce the fact that you're going to have your students do a civic action project, similar to the exercise we did at the beginning of this webinar, where you would play the video and ask them to identify what they think the issue is, see what kind of connections to policy they may have heard, and see what kind of actions they can identify with the students took.
What's really important is the variety of civic action that students apply to develop their project. That is how you assess how successful they were with this particular project or effort. Not whether they've solved the problem, but how many different things they tried, how many different people they met or spoke to. That is really the measure of a successful CAP project.
And then finally, we do have a chat section. So both for our high school and our middle school Civic Action Project, we have two separate discussion boards. So once you've registered your students, they can participate in the discussion board to get more information about CAP. That their particular project. So what would happen is they might post about their issue, and then we have a national civic action youth board that's actually led by two students from Parkland. And the students have been trained. They've all done civic action projects. They've been trained to respond to students who might need some help moving forward in their CAP. So depending on what your school allows, there's another opportunity for them to get guidance on their civic action projects outside of the teacher.
Chris, you want to maybe share some of your experiences with the managing a CAP classroom in Florida?
Sure. So first thing I'll say is there's not one right way to do this. It really depends on what's going to work best for you and your students. So you could take and we've seen teachers do this, but you can take a traditional approach where you break your students into smaller groups based on common interest, and they begin to investigate a policy. And then within that group, they take on the various roles, figuring out the best approach to solving their concern. Other ways that we've seen it done is each student is charged with looking at a policy area that is of interest to them. And then the teacher has them present their interest area. And from there, the teacher then has the students vote on the policy area that they'd like to work on as a class. And the reason for this is it helps the teacher facilitate based on the needs of their kids if they approach it from a whole group perspective. The other benefit to this particular method is you also have far more students being able to take on the various roles, so that when it comes to the research piece or the public service announcement or figuring out, you know, your methods of persuasion, you have clumps of students being able to work on those various aspects of the project. You know, we've even have seen teachers, set up the four corners where, they'll have major thematic pieces of policy. The students, end up, aligning based on their interest. And then from there, they just have a discussion and talk about it as the kids begin to move around the room and, finally settle on the area in which they want to work. But regardless of the issue or regardless of the method chosen, the students are selecting the issue. That's the most important piece. The kids have to have that vested interest. And when they identify something of interest to them, they're going to be more inclined to do the research and follow through with it. And, we've seen a tremendous number of projects take place here in Florida that have come to fruition for kids because it was an issue that was important to them. But you as the teacher have that opportunity to decide how those groups are going to be formed because you are acting as the facilitator. You are guiding the students as they move forward. And so, based on that particular process, it then enables you as the facilitator to establish those goals and expectations for the students. So know exactly where they are and where they're headed. And, you know, the best way to do that is through the use of the planners. The planners will definitely set it up for you so that, you know, from step one, where they actually propose the issue to you, you know, we have a series of scaffolded questions that really get the students to think about what it is that they want to do. And then from there, you know, they think it through, they persuade, they create a series of questions and what we call the ask and answer activity. So all of these pieces are designed so that they can move on to that next expectation that you set.
Yeah, and then, thank you, Chris. And then after their CAP experience, it usually ends with some sort of culminating activity. And this can be done in a variety of ways. It can be done inside your classroom with students making presentations to the class. They can be showing a PowerPoint, a PSA. They can be showing simply a chart paper with an example of what their issue was, what their policy connection was, and showing what their civic actions were. They could possibly do a civics fair in the cafeteria and maybe invite younger classes to see small presentations about the work that they're doing.
And maybe some of the guests that they may have encountered or interviewed as they were developing their project.
Right, so having community members invited to that, policymakers invited. Those are other ways that you can have a culminating activity. I know the Boys and Girls Club, Chris, you want to talk really just about how the Boys and Girls Club does their culminating activity?
Yeah, so what we've done with the Boys and Girls Club of Central Florida is we bring them to the university. And what we do is we gather community leaders so that they have the authentic audience that they can pitch their solutions to. And in doing so, they take ownership of that final project. And I have to say that, you know, our community leaders that we bring in, you know, we're very deliberate as to who we invite, because we're bringing in the decision makers based on the areas that the students have researched, so that when they do present their policy and when they share their solution, the people in the room are going to be able to implement that solution. And, you know, as I shared, if, you know, the solutions have very little money attached, the decision makers in the room are always willing to take what the kids have proposed and put it into action. I think I shared earlier that this past showcase, we had a group of middle school students who were worried that the school district wasn't doing enough to communicate all of the services that were available to them regarding mental health. And so they created a poster, and the district took that poster, produced it, and distributed multiple copies to the schools in the county to be hung in the areas that are most visited and frequented by students. We've had One of the last projects this year, we had the idea of sharing tables. And so students that weren't eating unopened food, if it could just be, you know, left in a central area, so that students that wanted more food or needed to have food for the weekend, whatever the case might be, they had access to that. And so we had the head of food services that was able to coordinate that with all of the cafeterias and set up procedures so that schools that were interested in doing that had that support structure. And it ended up really being successful. We've seen some middle schools significantly reduce the amount of waste, which in the end has actually saved the school district some money. So those are just a few of the things. But what I will say is that the model that the Boys and Girls Club uses is looking at that condensed version, because they do use it as an after-school activity, and so they only have the students for 2 hours a week to be able to work on this. And so they have started their projects now. They're working on them, and they'll be back to the university in May to present this year's projects.
And I think really having that experience where they are presenting it in front of people who really do have a say in the matter, it's really impactful to the students, because they do realize that they do have that civic voice, and hopefully now that they have this civic voice, realize that they have it, they have the skills and the knowledge that this will help them as they graduate and move on in career and civic college, career and civic life.
And that is the outcome that we're trying to facilitate, or the civic moment when they are able to convey their message to the decision maker. So that's really what we're trying to facilitate. We want students to be able to, once again, have an opportunity to influence the decision of the decision maker, the policy maker. So Chris, you wanted to talk a little about this particular grade?
Yeah, sure. So I would qualify John Dewey as being the godfather of social studies. And, you know, he was very much into this idea of an experience. And I think that Laura Gregorio and I have really made that a priority, because you're exposing the students to the skill set that comes along with the content knowledge that you're imparting. And so anytime you can create an experience for your students, you're affording them the opportunity to inquire, investigate, problem solve, you know, changing the way that your students perceive their learning. And I think through this experience, you end up connecting your content and your methods so that students feel like they're participating in their education. And so as they engage in this policy problem solving, you're providing this safe instructional environment for your students, because you can support the students and afford them the opportunities to address these controversial issues that affect them. And really, in the end, and if you all want to move to that next slide, it's sort of a perfect transition here. It helps them to address this question of what should we do, right? This is a question that all good citizens should ask. And this question was posed by Dr. Peter Levine out of Tufts University. And it really got me to think about, okay, you know, what should we do? And in all honesty, I think regardless of what you're teaching, you can use your content to answer, you know, this question. You know, first and foremost, I think it helps students answer the question, why am I learning this? Why am I having to know this information? And so, you know, I think this is a good prep step to start students thinking about democracy and whether it's important in their lives. The question, what should we do, is, you know, intrinsic. It's about values and principles. You know, it implies an understanding of the options that, you know, exist for the students, the probabilities of them succeeding, and the costs and consequences to, you know, taking these actions. And so I think that you can then sort of prioritize the content to, you know, help answer what we should do through deliberation, collaboration, and, you know, relationship building. You know, when we talk about deliberation, we're wanting to make sure that, you know, students, you know, deliberate with one another, that they are hearing alternatives, you know, and really sort of, you know, deciding then, okay, well, how can we collaborate on this? You know, how can we connect this talking to action? And then, basically building those voluntary ties, those peer relationships that, you know, move students so that they can end up, you know, accomplishing their goals.
Thanks, Chris. And of course, the outcome being the development or graduation or cultivation of effective citizens through that CAP process.
So we're getting towards the end, so we're going to open up some question and answer, but just wanted to reiterate CAP in kind of brief steps, right? The first step is obviously the teacher teaching the lesson, and then submitting the class roster for a student, and then students will be able to take that information through the planners, where they'll be able to identify issues that they care about, and that, I think, part is super key to Civic Action Project, is really making it meaningful for the students to be able to work on something they care about, not just something that the teacher is assigning. So that kind of what brings the buy-in for the student. Connecting their issue to policy, so it's different than a, you know, maybe establishing a cleanup for a day, because you're establishing policy, you're creating that sustaining piece. And then finally planning, completing different, a variety of civic actions, and then ending with a culminating activity where the students are reflecting on their civic action experience. So you can register for the free curriculum just by going to the CAP website. On the top right-hand corner, they'll say log in. There'll be a place for you to register. On your dashboard, when you get there, there's a place for you to submit your class roster. Then we just ask that you keep us posted on social media. You can use the hashtag CRFCAP, and we're happy to reach feed or, you know, put something on Instagram of what you're doing. But we'd love to see some examples of your students' work so that we can share that with other teachers in CAP classrooms around the nation.
So at this point, the formal webinar is over, but we're going to stick by for a few more minutes to answer any questions you may have about using the CAP resource. Thank you very much, Chris and Val, for joining us here today. You guys really have the most experience when it comes to implementing this in real communities with students. So we really thank you for participating and helping us out today.
So if you are doing CAP or thinking about doing CAP, this was a perfect opportunity to, you know, pick Chris's brain about what this looks like in the classroom and how this might work with your middle school students.
And of course, you can always just email us with your questions.
All right, we're going to go ahead and sign off. Thank you, Chris and Val, and thank you everyone who's able to attend. We really appreciate it.
Sure, no, thanks for having us.
Thank you, guys.